Hello and welcome back. Chris and Randy here with Marksman Shooting Sports and WeBuyGuns.com in Westfield, Indiana. You are watching Marksman TV, and today we have another unboxing video. Let's go ahead and dig in these boxes and see what we got today. If that sounds interesting to you, stick around. That's coming up right now. All right, first up today, we have one from a customer in Arizona. Cut a little deeper than I meant for it, too. Okie dokie. We have a macro. Okay. This looks like... How y'all doing? All right, guys. Sorry about that. We had somebody come in while we were unboxing this. Right here, we have a Makarov PM. Specifically, this is a German variation. One of the quickest ways you could tell are these black, sort of bakelite, plasticky type grips. Pretty indicative of a German Makarov. Now, the Makarov would actually come into fruition first in Russia in the 1950s. It's part of a weapons program to replace things like the TT-33 Tokarev and the AT-95 Nagant revolver, which were in Russian service. They would go to the slightly smaller 9x18 Makarov cartridge between about the traditional 380 and 9mm that we know of today, 9x19 Makarov. It would actually see so much success that other countries would adopt it. Germany, China would have a variation, and there was even other similar designs like the Polish 1-0 P-83 and the P-64, which had the fixed barrel straight blowback principle, derived very much off of the PP and PPK out of Germany. So very cool, becoming more and more collectible, just interesting little pistols. What do you think about that one?
I would say surplus, very good.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Being from probably the 1960s or actually dated 1963, I would say that given its condition, I would say surplus very good compared to other Makarovs I've seen. Customer said good. So we're in line there. So yep. Very cool pistol. Big thank you to our customer from where?
Arizona
for sending this one in to us. We will move on to the next one.
Next up, Chris, is one from a customer in Florida. Thank you for sending this in to us. Yes, please.
Now you need the scissors.
Now I need the scissors. Mm-hmm. See how it is.
Springfield.
Tech pack. Looks like we have a Springfield 1911 operator in 45 ACP. Very nice looking piece. Front and rear serrations, all
nine,
the features.
Nine sights. Accessory rail on the bottom. So Springfield would come out with their traditional 1911 A1 configuration. Gosh, it's been over 10 years ago. I know that because I got one as a wedding gift. I've been married for over 10 years. So, anyway, they have since come out with lots. They have since come out with lots of different variations off of that. So they have the loaded models, the operator, the range officer operator, the target, all sorts of different versions of that. Like all the other manufacturers who put out 1911s like Kimber and Colt, they have different variations. Now this is towards their higher end of their offerings, but they are still not overly expensive for what they are. So this is going to have more of a loaded type feature. So ambidextrous safety controls, extended beaver tail safety, skeletonized hammer and trigger, Novak. Looks like combat sights or night sights, front and rear serrations, accessory rail down here at the bottom. This one's chambered in 45 ACP. So very nice pistols. I really like mine. I always have for quite a while, but mine's just a watered down A1. Very cool handguns nonetheless. What do you think about that one?
Some very minor takedown marks, Chris. But I would definitely say very good. If it were not for the takedown marks, I would say excellent.
Yeah, I would put it at very good as well, again, because of that. But other than that, looks fantastic. That is what the customer said, so we'll move on to the next one. All right, guys, next up we have one from a customer in Ohio. Man, they used industrial strength tape. Got right in. No big deal. Pow.
He is still not in.
This part right here. That's all. There we go. See? No big deal.
By the time you edit out all of you're still not in.
Okay. Double. There we go. See? No problem. Lots and lots of bags.
Need some bags, John?
Oh, okay, I remember this. Dang, I was afraid of that. I was hoping that was tape. Okay, what we have here is a 1911 A1. This is World War II era. Some interesting things going on with this particular one. So by the looks of it, it's an A1, so it would be World War II era. It's got the sort of, what I want to call it, parkerized finish with the Fibrite type grip panels indicative of the A1 configuration with the little scallop cuts in the side of the frame. Now on A1, they would go to a shorter trigger. This has a traditional 1911 trigger in it, so that's obviously been replaced. Now the slide is marked Ithaca. The inspector's mark here on the side is GHD, so I believe that this is actually a Colt frame, so it's sort of mismatched frame and slide. Although that could have been done through a re-arsenaling, because the finish on actually both look very consistent with one another. The one only real negative thing about this is somebody decided to stipple the front strap of the frame. Now, this is actually done by sort of, I don't know, kind of notching into the front strap of the frame. So the frame, as far as collectability is concerned, totally ruined. So that really hurts the collectability of the pistol. Being a mix-match gun in terms of the frame and the slide, not a big deal through rearmament of these things, is because they would go on to serve in Vietnam and things like that until they would be replaced by the Beretta M9 in about 1982. That's part of its traditional military history and heritage, but that does really hurt the value of these sorts of things. But still, a really cool 1911 A1 World War II era piece of Americana nonetheless. So this would make a good shooter for somebody, or maybe a place filler and a collection for somebody who doesn't want to drop the higher amounts of money for a sort of unmolested version of this pistol. But anyway, with that being said, what do you think about the condition of that one?
I was getting a pretty good look at it while you had it over there, and I see the stippling thing now. If it were not for that, I would say surplus good to even the high end of good, but with this, since the frame is the gun, I can't give it better than fair.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. If it weren't for that, and remember, keep in mind, in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s, these things were not viewed as collectibles as they are today. Somebody probably picked it up, maybe at a gun shop or a hardware store, for less than that what they would have paid for like a brand new Smith & Wesson revolver or something like that. So these things were not really collectible. So somebody, you know, changed it up a little bit to make it more appealing to their likings. People do that with Glocks today. They'll stipple Glocks. So whoever did this back in the day did it without knowing that later in 2023 or 2023 that these things would be more coveted as collectibles. So again, because of that, because of what it is, I would have to say fair condition shooter grade as well. If it weren't for that, this would easily be good to very good. So anyway, disappointing on that, but still cool nonetheless. Let's move on to the next one. Oh, and by the way, I did forget to mention that the customer did say fair, and they did point out in the pictures and everything the stippling and pointed out the different frame and slide. So that was totally made aware to us when we made the offer. So no surprises. There you go. Thank you very much. We'll move on to the next one.
Next up, Chris, is one from a customer in Nevada. Thank you very much for sending that in to us.
And it's just a gummy compact.
So what we have is a M&P9 Shield 2.0 9mm, Chris.
Yeah, so this one was not wrapped up in any regard. It's just kind of floating around in the box.
Yeah.
We do recommend using some packaging material. Fortunately, it looks like this one got here fine. Doesn't look like any type of scratches or anything from the cardboard. But yeah, this is a Shield 2.0. So the first generation Shield, which actually I still carry, came out in about 2012. The 2.0s came out when? 2016, 2017? Somewhere around there.
That's about right.
Is that about right? And then now they have the Shield Plus, which came out about a year and a half ago, which is the 1.5 stack, 10, 11 round capacity. These are traditionally 7 and 8 rounds and 9mm. They also manufacture them in 40, and then a slightly larger version in 45 ACP, which went immediately to the Gen 2. So anyway, with the Gen 2, you have the more aggressive grip stippling, you have front sight serrations, and that was really about it stylistically. This has 3-dot sights. basic, cool pistols. I've always been a fan of the shield line. What do you think about the condition of that one?
It's got some scratches on the slide. They're all minor. High end to good, up to maybe even very good.
Yeah, that's exactly where I am. High end good, low end very good. Customer did not include the paperwork with the pistol other than their driver's license and our FFL. So we'll have to double check on that, but I'm sure we're close enough. So anyway, big thank you to our customer for sending this one in. We will move on to the next one. All right, next up we have one from a customer in Massachusetts. Big thank you for selling this one to us.
Probably our FFL.
We're getting there.
That's our FFL.
Nothing else in there. All right, six. P365. This is the standard version with the thumb safety, 10 round capacity. Guys, we've had many of these unboxed on this channel. Not going to go too much into details on this. But it is SIG's micro compact concealed carry version with the polymer frame. Come out from SIG now, it's been what, 4 years ago, 3 years ago? And this would introduce the competition into the small frame, high capacity pistols that we have out today from every manufacturer. So the SIG P365 is kind of the one to sort of first pioneer that. And that's what this is. Not much else really to say about it. That has not already been said a million times on our channel. What do you think about that one?
Looks excellent to me, Chris.
Me too. It looks fantastic, like new condition. Customer, again, did not put the paperwork in the box, so we do not know what they said, but I'm sure it's something similar to that. So again, big thank you to our customer in Massachusetts. We will move on to the next one.
Next up is one from a customer in New Jersey. Thank you very much for sending that in to us. Well, it's freezer pack, Chris.
I love it. It actually packaged very well.
Actually, you put your lunch in there and put this on here and like stay cold the entire day.
All right. SIG P320. This one's in 45 ACP. There we go. Okay. 45 ACP. SIG P320 would first come out in 9mm and 40 Smith & Wesson. This would come off of the SIG P250 line, which had an internal concealed hammer, double action only. Everybody knows about the P320. Again, we've had a million of them on this channel before. It is now adopted by the U.S. military as the M17 and the M18. Now, this one is in 45 ACP. The 45 version of the SIG would come out 2 or 3 years later after the SIG P320 would first initially launch. And that is what this is. Don't see them too often in 45 ACP. Very cool. This one has been back for the factory recall. It does have night sights on it. Not much else really to say. What do you think about the condition of that?
Man, I see a scratch on it, Chris. I would say excellent.
I agree. And this is, again, the third one in a row where we don't have paperwork from the customer. So we're flying blind here, guys. Anyway, we can look it up. Not a big deal. Big thank you to our customer from where? New Jersey?
Jersey, yes.
Jersey. Thank you. We will move on to the next one. All right, next up, we have yet another one from a customer in New Jersey. Big thanks for sending that one to us. Okay, no big deal.
Scratch your way through.
I did do the backstroke on that one. There you go. It's actually a good puzzle.
Yep, keep it.
It's an AR of some sort. Man. There we go.
Now A2. An A2 grip there. So.
I think it's an A1. No, you're right. It's an A2. Stag. Stag AR-15, A2 stock, A2 pistol grip, probably a 20-inch barrel. Actually feels kind of heavy. Stag is yet another one of probably 50 different manufacturers of AR-15s today. I like Stag, though. Stag's been around longer than most.
They're mil-spec, famous for making left-handed M16s for the military.
There you go. 5.56 Dado. Not much else really to say about it. What do you think of that one? Is that a Midwest handcart, or does it say? No?
Not marked.
Basic, probably a build of some sort.
It just has a few minor marks on it. I would say very good condition, Chris.
That's what the customer said. I totally agree. Not much else really to say about it. Cole at home, A2 type build. Let's move on to the next one.
All right, Chris, up is yet another one from New Jersey. Customer, but thank you very much for sending that in.
It's almost like a full cab, you would say. Cabs are here.
Cabs are here.
That's all I know about New Jersey.
Magazine's here.
Max are here.
Max are here.
Max is
here.
716? 715. 715? What do they call this? The
715T?
715,
yeah. No paperwork.
Paperwork's here.
715T. Yeah. What you have here is a 22LR-esque version of an AR-15, kinda. It's really just a clamshell couple halves that look like an AR-15 that are threaded together. Magazine release is actually here. The charging handle is here. So again, this T-handle here is fake, just a molded piece. So it kind of gives the aesthetics and looks of an AR-15, but it functions more like a Ruger 10/22 with a sort of an odd lever magazine release here. If you're looking for something that's more akin to an actual AR-15, the Smith & Wesson M&P 15/22 is more what I recommend. But these are fine plinkers. They are not super expensive. You're $100 to $200, you know, on something like this, new or used. So still just a fun little plinker nonetheless, kind of giving that tactical aesthetic. What do you think about the condition of that one?
I don't know what to say. I guess it looks...
I don't know what to say about this.
Let's just call it very good.
Yeah.
Since the magazines fell on the floor.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Now that they've fallen on the floor, it would have been excellent. No,
yeah.
I would honestly say excellent.
Yeah.
Very good to excellent. I mean, it looks fine. It has some marks up here on the barrel, so maybe very good. But see, the magazines are kind of weird, too. Again, everything is done to make it look like an AR-15. But also at the same time made to make it not function like an AR-15. So that is what we have achieved here with this. And the magazine releases on these are always really weird. But anyway, very cool. Thank you so much for sending this one into us. We will move on to the last one. All right, last up, we have one from a customer in Nevada. Thank you for selling this one to us. Come on. Come on now.
Come on now. Empty box. Yep.
Got it?
Yep.
Sure is a beaut, Clark.
It is not clear.
Okay. IWI Tavor X95. So the Tavor in its first iteration would hit the market in the United States well over 10 years ago. It's probably been 12-ish years at this point. Known as the SAR, I believe. SAR-1, what do they call that thing? The SAR?
The first one, yeah.
Yeah, the very first one, which I actually prefer over the X95. Now, the X95 was the micro, but it had to have a little bit of a longer length on its receiver to meet American importation restrictions. These are, of course, made in Israel. Well, the IDF has been using the micro Tavor for at least the last 10 years. And that is what this is meant to mimic. It does have this barrel collar here at the front, so not truly a free floated barrel. Because of that, these had some early accuracy issues that have since, I believe, been addressed. They did move the magazine release here to the side of the firearm versus back here, which were on the first generation Tavor. A lot of people would accidentally bump into that with their dominant hand dropping their mag on tactical reloads and stuff like that or whatnot. Interesting firearms. Of course, a lot of people really like the Tavor series, and it is a favorite in the bullpup lineup for most people for a good reason. They're really good, ergonomic, very good recoil impulse, and accurate firearms. So I've always been a fan of the Tavor. What do you think about that?
Very minor marks on it, I would have to say. Very good, Chris.
Yeah, I would agree. Customer did say good. I'm a little higher than that. Yeah, there's a few marks on it, but I'm definitely at a solid, very good on this one. So we're good with that. That's basically it. Anything else you want to add about the Tavor?
No, this particular one's in 5.56.
Yeah.
They come in 5.56, 300 blackout, and 9mm.
Yeah, they make a 9mm version that takes the 9 mags, and they make the larger version of this, the Tavor 7 and 7.62 NATO. So, cool platform. Anyway, guys, that is a good one for us to end it out on. Thank you so much for stopping by and checking out this video. If you enjoyed, please let us know by hitting that like button. Please also consider subscribing to our channel and hit that bell notification button so you are aware when we are posting new content. We're going to leave you guys off with that. I am Chris.
And I'm Randy.
And we will see you next time.
Always cut towards yourself. That way, if the knife slips, you don't hurt anybody else.
I like that. Muzzle direction here. Urban defense. It's interesting. That's where the muzzle's pointing.
Oh, no, it's pointing right at me. Flag, flag, flag.
It was pointed at you.
They fooled me.
Always point your own gun at yourself to save yourself from hurting anybody else.
That's right. Safety tip number two.
Cabs here.
Cabs here.
M&P 15.
Yeah, just go with one of those. Yeah.